Good morning. Woo! All right, if you'd stand with us this morning, we're going to sing He Keeps Me Singing. Sure how to fix that. James is gone and everything just falls apart. So we're just going to make do, but we are going to sing my favorite song, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart.
Since Jesus came into my heart, 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 since J right. Well, good morning, church. Glad we're awake this morning. I'm getting them warmed up for you, David. I will go through our announcements quickly. On the inside, there's one announcement on our women's Bible study that will start back here in just a few weeks, there at the beginning of August. If you have ordered a book, they're here. You can see Legan after church. She's got the books. If you haven't signed up, you can still do that. There's still time to do that. Would love for you to join us. If you're a lady looking for some fellowship, looking for some Bible study, you can see her for more info. We'll start that back here in just a few weeks. Don't forget about OCC. We're still collecting this month. So don't forget about those items that are listed there in your bulletin. And then you can still order t-shirts. I'm still going to leave the sign-up sheet out there for another week or two before I put that order in. So if you haven't signed up for one, feel free. Our first sheet's filled up pretty full. I've got another one sitting out there so we can start another sheet. They're $12 a piece. You can see pictures. There's a sample sitting on the counter as well out there. And if you want to pay, you can pay now, pay later. You can write a check and write it for t-shirts or whatever, put it in the offering box or however you want to do that. Don't feel the pressures like, I don't have the money, I don't want to sign up right now. You can go ahead and sign up, and we'll get that taken care of. Also, if you weren't here last week, I mentioned we're going to start a new Sunday school class here. Going to start on August the 25th next month. So if you're a younger adult and feel like you haven't found a Sunday school class that you might fit in, we're starting one that's geared more towards you. We'll start off studying personal spiritual disciplines. We'll meet in this empty classroom in room D right behind the sanctuary. And so if that's something that interests you, you can find me. I'll be leading that class with my wife, Kaylee. She's in nursery right now, so she's not in here. But I'd love to give you more information. And if you're interested, there's a sign up for that just so I can know how many books to order. We'll provide the book for you, the study guide for you. So if that's something you feel like, hey, I want to fellowship with some people my age, I want to go through a study in Sunday school with people my age, sign up, talk to me, be glad to give you more info. All right, at this time, if you are an usher this morning for our offering, we'll go ahead and invite you down to the front, come forward. And while they're coming, I'll do my best to put my James hat on since he's not here today and plug the concert because I know it's important to him. It's coming up soon, August the 3rd at 6 o'clock. I know there's flyers out there. If you want to pick one up, put them your place of business or wherever that may be. I know he'd appreciate that. He's not here, so I'm going to plug that for him this morning. I know I don't look or sing like him, but I'll do my best to give you the info like him this morning. But this time, let's go ahead and let's pray for our time of offering, and then as we enter in to the rest of our worship time. Lord, what a blessing it is to be in your house this morning, to be able to worship you through songs, to be able to worship you through the preaching of your word, and to be able to just gather and fellowship with believers. You tell us not to neglect that, and so we're thankful to be able to do that this morning. And so as we are gathering the offering and giving back things that you have provided for us, we ask your blessing on those as they go to further your kingdom, both here in Glasgow, Barron County, and through our nation, through our world, wherever that may be, so that those that don't know you can come to know you, Lord. And so bless the rest of this time together as we sing and as we open your word. And it's your son's name that we pray. Amen.
child of God. Yes, I am. Yes, He has ransomed His grace for me. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died. Chosen, not forsaken. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who You say I am. You are for me, not against me.
If you'd stand with me as we continue with worship, children are dismissed to children's church right now to go along with the service that's coming to create. a clean heart.
Well, good morning, Southside.
Will you have your son and his family stand?
I will. I sure will. I was been given instruction. We have our son and his wife and one of our grandsons. Alexi went back, and their friends Blake and Megan. So y'all stand up. We got to welcome you to Southside. So praise the Lord for that. Now, you can't miss church. They just drove all the way from Florida to come to church. So you can't miss church. Well, praise the Lord for that. I want to invite you to open your Bibles to Psalm 51. And as you are turning there to Psalm 51, where we're going to be today, I want to show you a couple pictures there. Go ahead and show one picture. This is our high school prom. Yeah, we dance. And that's... today's our 45th wedding anniversary, so. Praise the Lord. All right, take it off here then. All right, good deal. All right, let's go to the next screen. Thank you for that. Praise the Lord. As we've been married 45 years, as one of the guys said in our church, his name was Raymond Gill. He and his wife had been married for like 55 years or something like that, and I said, well, how's it been? He said, well, 45 of those years have been pretty good. So But I honestly could say we've enjoyed our time together. Praise the Lord for that. I guess on your 45th wedding anniversary, you're supposed to buy your wife a sapphire. So I told Teresa that. She said she already had one. So praise the Lord for that. So I didn't have to do that. All right. All right, Psalm 51. It's good to have a good time in God's house. I want to tell you that I really struggled this week with putting this message together. I just want to be honest with you about that. And it's not because I had a hard time with the verse necessarily or with my study. It's not because I didn't have enough time to study. That's not it. And it's not because I never heard this verse before. I've heard this verse and read this verse and this chapter many, many times. The reason why I struggled is because I struggled with the content that was found in this passage of Scripture. And as I was reading this passage and studying this passage of Scripture, it felt like the Lord just really gripped my heart with some things, my own personal life that I'd stored back and had not been willing to deal with. But God's timing is always perfect, and He revealed some things to me out of this passage of Scripture, and I pray that God would do the same thing for you today as well as we look at this very familiar passage of Scripture. Now, I want to call your attention to something today. I think this is only the second time I've ever done this in 35 years of ministry, and that is I want to give you an invitation this morning that at any time during this service, while I'm preaching, if you sense that God is speaking to your heart about something, I want to give you an open invitation that you are more than welcome to come to this altar at any time during the service and to talk to the Lord. We're here in God's house. We're in church today. We're before Him in His presence. And I think it's a great opportunity for you to go ahead and to come and to do some business with God if the Lord would lead you to do that. So I just want to give you that invitation. So let's get into the text here today in Psalm 51. The verse is not going to be on the screen, but this is a powerful prayer. And in the Bible, there are some amazing prayers that are voiced to the Lord. And I can't go into all of those prayers today, but I just want to identify a few of those prayers for you today. You might remember the prayer that Solomon prayed in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, chapter 6. He is petitioning the Lord in 2 Chronicles chapter 6 and praying to God, and they're getting ready to dedicate the temple. And you get to 2 Chronicles chapter 7, and it's not verse 14, it's verse 1 and following. Listen to Solomon's prayer. The Bible says, after Solomon had finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. Now that phrase, the glory of the Lord filled the house, is used more than one time in chapter number 7. What a prayer. Solomon is praying to the Lord, and as soon as he finishes, the glory of God shows up in the house of God. Oh, that would happen today. Would I get a witness here today? Jonah's prayer. In Jonah chapter 2, it's only four chapters long, you know, and Jonah 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3, and chapter 4, you know, that God restores Jonah, and he does preach, and finally he does in a reluctant way. But in Jonah chapter 2, that's when God, catches Jonah by this great fish. The Bible says they threw him overboard. Now, some of you believe that as soon as Jonah was thrown overboard, that the fish came up and swallowed him. I don't believe that. I believe that when they threw him overboard, that he got into the water and he sank all the way down to the bottom, and God provided this fish. Because if you read Jonah chapter 2, it is his prayer of going all the way down into the depths of the sea. The Bible says Jonah prayed to his God from out of the stomach, out of the belly of the fish, and he said, I called out of my distress to the Lord. He answered me. I cried for help out of the death of Sheol, and you heard my prayer. Powerful prayer. You might remember the prayer of Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and sitting on a throne, and he said, woe is me, for I am ruined, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. You might remember that powerful prayer that Daniel prayed in Daniel chapter 6. Listen to what the Word of God says. When Daniel knew that the document was signed, the contract was signed, he entered his house and he continued kneeling on his knees three times a day, praying and giving thanks before his God, as he had been doing before. That was right before Daniel prayed that prayer, right before he got thrown into the lion's den. You might remember Jesus' prayer in Luke chapter 22. The Bible says he withdrew from them about a stone's throw. He knelt down and began to pray, saying, "Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." And being in agony, he was praying very fervently, very earnestly, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling upon the ground. That is an intense prayer from our Savior, Jesus Christ. But now you get to Psalm 51. And Psalm 51 is a psalm that is full of many things. It's full of agony. It's full of energy. It's full of emotion. It's full of weight. It's full of guilt. David is even going to use that word guilt in this verse. It's a psalm full of brokenness before God. But it's also a psalm that's full of freedom. And someone here today needs to be set free from the bondage of sin. So if you have that outline that is on the seat in front of you that you saw on that seat, let me give you five words to fill in on the outline. I gave you some of the verses here. The first word I want to call your attention to is the word revealing. The word revealing. You might remember if you were here last week that we preached out of 2 Samuel chapter 11 and chapter 12. And 2 Samuel chapter 11, that is David, that he had committed this egregious sin with Bathsheba. And chapter 12 is when Nathan comes and confronts David about this sin. It is a revealing. And we find in the Bible a contrast between what I consider two leading men. Here's the two leading men. You have Joseph in Genesis, the Bible, the Word of God in the book of Genesis, about 25% is written about Joseph. And then you have David, King David. Now think about Joseph for a moment. The Bible says that Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers, but yet the Bible says he became very successful. The Bible says that Joseph was a handsome man, very attractive man. And the Bible says that Potiphar's wife tried to seduce Joseph. Matter of fact, Genesis 39:10 records these words. She spoke to Joseph every day. Day after day, he would not listen to her, and he kept out of her way as much as possible. The Bible goes on in Genesis 39 and records these words about Joseph. But one day he went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house was there in the house because she had emptied the house. And she caught Joseph by his garment, saying, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand, and he fled, and he got out of the house. So there's Joseph, one of these great men that God used, being pursued by a woman that wanted to have relations with him. And Joseph runs out, literally naked, and leaves his coat there, his cloak there, and runs away. Now, the other side of that story, the contrast to that is David. David, King David. He didn't do what Joseph did. He should have been on the battlefield, 2 Samuel chapter 11 says, but he stayed back home. He began to rest, and he woke up, and he wandered on top of his rooftop one day. He sees this beautiful woman, a woman that is beautiful to look at. But instead of running back into his house, David acts on his desires and his lust, and he gives in to the sinful actions with Bathsheba. That's when Nathan comes in and confronts David and reveals to David that David had committed this egregious sin, not only against Bathsheba, not only against Uriah, but also and mainly against God himself. Nearly 1 year had passed, and David had been trying to conceal his sin, but yet he refused to deal with the guilt of his actions, and God sends Nathan in his life to do that. Now, I want to call your attention to two thoughts here this morning. They're not going to be on your outline, and they're not going to be on the screen, but here's thought number one. Sin is serious, and sin can lead to a downward spiral that affects other people. Sin is serious and can lead to a downward spiral that will eventually affect other people. It happened in the life of David. It affected Uriah. He had him at the front of the battle line. Uriah was killed. It affected Bathsheba. The child that she delivered would eventually die. It affected David because he was tormented for almost an entire year. It affected God's people because the word of God, Nathan said to him, he said, I'm going to allow your wives even to be put in a public square and to be defamed before the entire people. And it affected God. David's relationship between him and God and what David did broke God's heart. So number one, sin is serious, can lead to a downward spiral. Number two is this, and please hear this, even the most godly people fall into terrible sin. Amen? You don't have to go to that second word yet. You can just back up. I'm not quite there yet. Even the most godly people can fall into terrible sin. We've seen it, have we not? We've seen it out in public. We've seen that over the last several days and weeks and even before that. Now, it's not an excuse, but please hear my heart. We cannot laugh at our sin. God doesn't laugh at it, and we should not laugh at our sin either. David was constantly haunted by this sin. David was in pain every day with his sin. Paul even records it over in Romans chapter 7. He talks about his own sin. He said, "Wretched man that I am, who will set me free from this body of death?" Jeremiah talks about our sinful heart. He said, "The heart is deceitful above all else, and it is desperately wicked. It is sick. Who can understand it?" You say, "Well, preacher, how can you know that David was in pain every day?" Because over and over again in Psalm 51, you will read this word or this phrase, because David talks about losing his joy. He mentions it in verse 8, he mentions it in verse 12, he mentions it in verse number 14. David had carried this awful burden about the sin that he had committed with Bathsheba and trying to cover it up for almost an entire year. This heavy burden, this heavy weight, and it was crushing him every day. But thanks be to God that he sent a prophet, Nathan, to confront David to reveal his sin. Would you say amen to that? So word number one is revealing. Word number two is the word request. Look at verse number one and two. It's right here in the text. David begins to beg. David begins to pray. David begins to talk to the Lord in verse number one and two. "Be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the greatness of your compassion. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." Three strong words there in verses 1 and 2. They sound like the same thing, transgressions, iniquity, and sin. And we could agree that they probably are the same thing. But those three words mean something different in the context. The word transgression simply means this, my rebellion against God. David was saying, "Lord, according to your greatness, blot out my rebellion. Blot out the battle that I've had against you." Can't you imagine what happened in David's life? Here's a man that's after God's own heart. A man that had a relationship with God prior to this sin. A man who had been trying to follow the Lord. And now David commits and falls into this situation of sin. And now for almost an entire year, he's been trying to cover up this sin. And as a believer in God, I'm sure God has been trying to intervene into his life. And David kept trying to keep it in secret place, in a place where no one could find out. It became a battle. The word iniquity means corruption. It means my rottenness before you. David's sin had been revealed. Now David is making a request to God, and he is seeing his sin for what it is. It's rebellion. It's rottenness. And, of course, the word sin is the Greek word hamartia, which simply means that he was falling short of following the Lord. All the way through, everybody still with me would say amen? All the way through this passage of Scripture, David's request is filled with deep, deep emotion from his heart. Have mercy, blot out, wash me, cleanse me, purge me, let me, create in me. Cast me not, take not away from me, restore to me, deliver me. And David is drawing back from his relationship that he had with God. Look again at verse number one. If your Bibles are open there, it says, "According to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy," or your tender mercies. Again, remember, David was a man after God's own heart. He had a relationship with God, but listen, church, but his sin got in the way of that relationship with God. Please listen to your pastor this morning. Sin and service cannot work together. Let me say it again. Sin and service cannot work together. You can't be living in sin and serving Jesus at the same time. You can't have some secret sin hidden in your closet somewhere and come out here and try and serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, you could fake us out, I could fake you out, but you can never fake God out. And David is crying out to God, the only person that he can cry out to, the God of mercy, according to your steadfast love, according to your tender, abundant mercies. I need your forgiveness, God. You could judge me, and he does, but you're also the God of love. There's a revealing, word number two. There's a request, word number three. There's a reminder. There's a reminder in this passage of Scripture. Look in verse number three and verse four. Verse 3 and 4, David says it to him. He says, I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you and you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you might be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Notice what David says there in verse number 3. He says, I know my transgressions. If you were here last week, remember I gave the illustration of someone having a speck in their eye and the other person having a, and you have a beam in your eye. David is saying there in verse number 3, I believe what he's saying is he's saying, I know my transgressions. I know I've got a beam stuck out of my eye. I know I've got this horrendous sinful activity going on in my life. No one has to tell me about them. David, I believe, is saying these things are tearing me apart. They've been tearing me apart for at least a year. He's saying, I've kept them to myself, but I can't do it anymore. God, you have revealed to me my sin, and now I will do something about it. Notice what he says in verse 3. Are you still with me? Say amen. Verse 3, he says, my sin is ever, where is it, church? Before me. Now, God is going to forgive David. And God does forgive as far as the east is from the west. God does cast it into the sea, never to be remembered again, never to be elevated again. But David is saying about his own sin, he's saying it's always before me. He's not saying that I can't take that experience away. He had the experience, but he's saying that sin is ever before me. And I need to do something about it. Jesus has something to say about this. You can jot this reference down, Matthew chapter 5, verse 29 and 30. If your right eye makes you stumble, tear it out and throw it from you. It's better for you to lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. If your right hand makes you stumble, cut it off, throw it away from you. It's better if you lose one of the parts of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Matthew chapter 18, verse 9, similar language. If your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out and throw it away from you. It's better for you to enter into life with one eye than to have two eyes and be cast into fiery hell. David, the writer of many of the Psalms, in Psalm 139, verse 23 and 24, you know this verse. Search me, O God. Know my heart. Try me in my anxious thoughts and see if there be any wicked way in me and lead me in the way of everlasting. Listen, my dear friends, we're saved by the grace of God. Amen? But we struggle with sin in our life. And aren't you grateful that we have the tender mercies and the grace of Almighty God, that when we sin, we have an advocate with the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ, through the work of the Holy Spirit, that we can come to God and say, God, I'm sorry, I messed up again. Would you please forgive me? And guess what, church? God forgives us of our sin. At some point in time, God is going to bring your sinfulness out. He's probably going to do it when you're not planning on it. It's going to come out. Maybe a bad illustration. It's the only thing I think of. People that are addicted to methamphetamines. It cooks them from the inside out. It's one high after another. The more they do it, the greater the high is. And what happens is the evidence of it eventually comes out. It starts coming out of them. Same with sin. Sin is internal. But at some point, it's got to come out. And it's going to be revealed. That's the work of the light of the gospel. Light will always dispel darkness. Amen? Light will always dispel darkness. You say it's got to come out of the person. I've never heard someone, we've got one of our youth here today that a couple weeks ago broke out in a rash. I've never heard someone say that they broke in with a rash. Right? They broke out with a rash, which means something inside was going on in order for that to come on the outside. And the same thing with our sin. Our sin is inside. Our sin, the scripture tells us, Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So before your mouth speaks, something's going on internally in your heart. There's a revealing, there's a request, there's a reminder. Word number four, there's a requirement. It's right here in the text. It's in verse 6. It's also in verse 16 and 17. Notice what he says in verse 6. Behold, you delight in truth. In the inward being, you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Verse 16 and 17, for you do not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You do not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. I hope you have your Bibles open there, because in the midst of this wonderful psalm, David lets us in on a couple things that God reveals to him. And David receives some things from the Lord here. It's in this passage of Scripture. Notice what happens first of all in verse number 8. Everybody say verse 8. In verse number 8 it says, make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. What did David receive from the Lord? Number 1 is this, godly discipline. Look at the phrase again. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Godly discipline. David had sinned. David had been corrected. But there were some consequences from that. And David received discipline from God. David received correction from God. David received chastisement from God. He said, let the bones that you have broken, let them eventually begin to rejoice. The writer of Hebrews says it this way. God disciplines those that he loves. So what he's saying there in that passage of Scripture is, if you claim with your mouth that you're believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, but yet you can go out there and do all kinds of things, you can keep sinning, sin, 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 and you feel no remorse, you feel no conviction, you feel no regret over that sin, you feel no consequences of that sin, you feel no punishment from that sin, and you just keep on doing the same thing that you're doing over and over and over and over again, and you say, well, God's not going to do anything about that, that is proof that you're not a follower of God. You see, because one of the proofs of being a follower of God is that he's not going to let you just keep on sinning. He's going to intervene at some point in time in your life. That's the work of the Holy Spirit of God. When he, the Spirit of God, comes, he will convict the world of sin. That's one of the roles of the Spirit of God. Now listen, my dear friends, when you sin and you're convicted by the Holy Spirit of God, sometimes that hurts. Could I get a witness? Because he exposes us. He reveals what's going on in our lives. So God gives David godly discipline. Secondly, God gives David godly wisdom. It's in verse number 6. Verse number 6, he says again, behold, you desire truth in innermost, and in the hidden part you will make me. You desire in the innermost of my being truth. And at the end, and in the hidden part, you will make me know wisdom. Godly wisdom. Godly discipline. Godly wisdom. Help me, David is saying, to make godly choices. He already made a bad choice with Bathsheba, right? Bad choice. Now, he's saying, Lord, help me to make good, godly decisions. And let me go ahead and get on my soapbox here for just a moment, because that's what preachers love to do. Any kind of decision that you're going to make. Now, I'm not talking about going to McDonald's or going to Burger King or whatever it is and choosing what you're going to do. I'm not talking about, I don't think you need to pray about doing those things, right? Amen? Now, you might need to pray about going to White Castle. Now, I love White Castle. But any kind of decision you need to make individually, as a family, that is going to affect your life in a long-term, lasting way, that is something that you need the wisdom of Almighty God involved in your life. You need to take that before the Lord Jesus Christ. If it's a family situation, a financial situation, a spiritual situation, a church situation, you need to be on your face before Almighty God, and you need to be begging for his wisdom, and that's what David does. He says, teach me your wisdom. Godly discipline, godly wisdom. But look at verse number 12. Godly integrity. godly integrity. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and sustain me with a willing spirit. Uphold me with a willing spirit. What that is willing to obey you, God. I want my entire life focused on you. I want everything in my life to be centered around trying to please you, God, trying to serve you, God, trying to be willing to follow every part of my life. But notice what happens here. We're talking about the word requirement. What does God require from David? Well, just two things. Verse 6, he wants truth. Verse 16 and 17, he wants brokenness. Look in verse 6 again. You desire or delight in truth. But where is that truth coming from? Church? Are y'all here? In the innermost being. Here's what he's saying. David is saying, God, you desire and delight in truth. And God, you, verse 16 and 17, you desire and delight in brokenness and a contrite heart. What does God want from us? What does God want from you? He wants truth, honesty, and openness to him. What does God require from you? Let me tell you what he does not want. He doesn't want sacrifices. He doesn't want rituals. He doesn't want rote prayers. He doesn't want things that have no meaning. He doesn't want your secondary experiences in life. God requires a broken and a contrite heart. Here's what we do many times. Well, I'm going to say my two-minute prayer, and God's going to be fine with that, right? No. I'm going to give my little tip into the offering plate, and God's going to be fine with that because he understands my financial situation. No. I'm going to volunteer for about 20 minutes at church at OCC or something else that we've got in church, and God, I'll get a pat on the back for that. No. I'll go to church every Sunday. I'll go to Sunday school every Sunday. Some of you probably have the pins of perfect attendance probably hanging somewhere in your house. I don't know. They used to give those things out for perfect attendance, and people would come to church and they'd wear those things proudly. You know what that proved? It proved you went to church every week. That's it. Right? You're not going to be in another level of heaven than anyone else who's going to be there. God doesn't want all that. You know what God wants? He wants truth and a broken and a contrite heart. He's speaking to somebody here this morning. And you got something going on in your life. I've got stuff going on in my life. I'm not done. God's not done. He's opening some things, some channels in my life this past week that I've got to deal with, and he's revealing what those things are, and I'm struggling with some of those things, what those are, and I'm trying to work through those things, but I need the help of Almighty God. But in order for that to happen, I've got to be truthful with him. He already knows all things, right? He knows what's going on. He just wants me to agree with him about what's going on, be truthful about it, and then he wants me to come to him with a broken and contrite heart. Paul said it well in Romans 12. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. There's a revealing. Nathan is involved. There's a request. David is begging for the mercy of God. There's a reminder. My sin is ever before me. There's a requirement from God. Truth and brokenness. Which leads me to the last word that you could fill in the blank, and that is the word repentance. It's here in verse 14 and 15 of the text. Verse 14 and 15 says, deliver me. That's a word that we can use for repentance. David is tired of it. He said, deliver me from this blood guiltiness. What David is saying right there is, he said, this blood is on my hands. All these things that I've done them on my own volition. I did those outside of the will of God. Oh, God and God of my salvation, my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. Oh, Lord, open my lips and my mouth will declare your praise. Verse 11 and 12, if you go back up to that for just a second, he says, cast me not away from your presence. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of thy salvation. every new and upright spirit within me. We just sang about that. That was the last song. That was not by accident. That was by the plan going along with a message. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. What a beautiful, beautiful song. David says there in verse 11, don't cast me away from your presence. Don't take the Holy Spirit from me. David lost some things here. But let me tell you what he didn't lose. He did not lose his salvation. That's not what he's saying here. That's not what the text is saying. If you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, it is impossible for you to lose your salvation. The reason being is because God says that if you are in Christ, then you are in the power and the hands of Almighty God, and no one can pluck you out of the hand of God. Would you say amen to that? But at the same time, as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you just can't go out there and live the kind of life that you want to live like you used to live, because you're not supposed to be conformed to the world. You're supposed to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, and that is given to you by the Holy Spirit of God. Didn't lose his salvation, but what did he lose? He lost the joy of serving God. He had this sin build up in him for almost a year, and the joy just kept receding and receding away from his life. He lost the effectiveness and the witness of his testimony. No longer was testifying and telling people about the wonders of God. He lost the fire of the Lord in his life. Have you been there, church member? Have you been there before where the fire and the zeal of God just isn't there anymore? Same thing happened to David. He lost his motivation to tell others about God. But now that he's been restored, now that his sin has been exposed, now that he begs for forgiveness from God, now that reminder of that awful sin that is before him every day, he understands that God wants truth. God desires brokenness and a contrite spirit. And now God is going to restore him back to a right relationship because he repents from his sin. A couple things here. Look in verse 13, and I'll be done. Verse 13, notice what he says. Then, after this opportunity of repentance and restoration, he says, then I will teach transgressors. Who are these transgressors? People just like himself. I'm going to teach them your ways, and sinners will be converted to you. Verse 15, are you still there, church? Then I will open my mouth and declare your praise. Sounds like worship to me. Look in verse 14. Then my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. Verse 13, I'm going to teach some people about you. Verse 15, I'm going to open my mouth and declare your praise. Verse 14, my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. I love worship. Definitely love preaching. It's what God called me to do. So let me challenge you as a believer in Christ. If we have a word, you know, we sing on the wall, you know, words on the wall. That's what we do. You're not going to find a songbook around anymore. That's just where we are, okay? Get over that. If we sing a song that you don't know, don't sit there like a bump on a lung and say, well, I'm not standing. I know some of you can't stand. Don't stand there looking like this, like, hey, go sing that one. I don't like that one. I don't even know that one. That was not a Baptist song. I'm not going to sing anything like that. You know, and then when one comes up there, victory in Jesus, then you sing at the roof of your mouth. You look around while all these young people aren't singing it, and it's like, what's wrong with these people? Right? David committed an egregious sin. David was exposed for his sin. David was a man after God's own heart. God allowed him to repent and restored him back to a right relationship. And immediately, then I will tell others. Then I'm going to worship God. Then I'm going to start singing praise to God. Listen, my dear friends, we should not be a bump on a log. We should not be a sourpuss, if I could say that. We ought to be the greatest worshipers on the face of the earth until we see Jesus one day. I don't care if you don't sing or you can't sing. Sing to the Lord. You're not singing to me. You're not singing to somebody else. You're singing to God. Now, do these microphones work up here, William? Hey, there's a microphone over there and the microphone over there. So all you people right here singing, we can hear you. All you people over there singing, we can hear you. There's a microphone there. So you go home and you watch on Facebook and say, man, I sounded awful. I don't care what it sounds like. We sing and praise God for an audience of one. Right? And what does he want from us? He wants truth. He wants a broken and a contrite heart. I can't come to the altar, Pastor. People are going to think that I must have committed some egregious sin. I don't care. This is a great place to come and meet with God. The altar is a great place to come and pour your heart out to the Lord. The altar is a great place for you to do business with God. The altar is a great place for you to come, and when you pour your life out to the Lord Jesus Christ and you repent of that sin and you allow the Lord to come into those secret closets in your life and he restores you and he cleanses you and he makes you whole, what better place to stand up and rejoice than in the house of God? Sounds like David was ready to worship. I got one more verse. Revelation chapter 5. It's on the screen, I believe. John the Apostle says, "Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels around the throne, and the living creatures, and the elders, and the number of them was myriads of myriads, and thousands, and they were saying with a calm voice." No, they were saying with what, church? A loud voice. "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing, and every created thing which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and on the sea and all things in them." John says, "I heard them saying, to him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb, blessing and honor and glory and dominion forever and ever." And the four living creatures kept saying what, church? Amen! 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 And the elders fell down and they worshiped. I was reminded... There's a great account in Acts chapter 16. Of course, Acts 16 starts off with Lydia, the wealthy woman, the seller of purple garments, coming to faith in Christ. And then we have Paul and Silas being thrown into the prison, into the innermost depths of the prison for the preaching of the gospel. And then I think it's Acts 16, around verse 25, I believe, it says this phrase, "And about midnight." No lights, mud, the depth of the dungeon, chained together, and about midnight, Paul and Silas began singing praises to God. I think they sang "Victory in Jesus." Amen? I don't know what they sang. Maybe they sang "When We All Get to Heaven." I don't know what they sang. But they began to sing. And it had such an effect on everyone else, even on God, because they were worshiping God in the worst of their circumstances, that the Bible says a great earthquake happened. The doors in the prison were open. The chains were broken. And they walked out unharmed. But that's not the end of the story. Because that jailer that was guarding them knew that if they found out that they had been released, his neck was on the line. He would face death. But Paul said, nobody left. We're all still here, and we're still praising God. And that Philippian jailer said this phrase, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" I see how you guys responded. I see what you guys did in the worst of times. I want that for me. What do I need to do to be saved? Join the church? No. Carry a King James Bible? No. Sing the Heavenly Highways? No. Sing Hillsong Worship? No. What must I do to be saved? One thing, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Amen? Let's not make it difficult. Salvation is a free gift of God by the grace and the mercy of Almighty God through His Son, Jesus Christ. It cost Christ His life, but He died so that we wouldn't have to. We may die physically, but as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, we will not die spiritually, because my name is written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, and no one can take it out. I'll say it again, and I'll say it until Jesus comes. August 7th, 1977 was a day of transformation for my life when I went from hell to heaven, from death to life. And my life has never been the same since. Amen? Let's pray. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I don't know, dear friend, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, but you do. I can't force you. I can't make anyone do anything. But I know the Holy Spirit can speak to your heart. And if there's anyone here today who does not know Jesus as their personal Savior and Lord, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Dear Christian friend, would you just utter a simple prayer and pray for whoever that person is that may need to come to Christ? And dear Christian that is here today, are you carrying around any secrets? You got a little place back in your heart that you've got locked up and only you and you alone think that you know anything about? Is there something that God needs to come and speak to you about? We're going to sing a hymn, Have Thine Own Way. The Spirit of God is a gentleman. We'll sing. God will speak. But the decision is up to you. And Father, we love you. We praise you. Thank you for the gospel, for the word of God. Thank you, Lord, that you did your supernatural work in us, that you created a new heart out of a heart of stone in our lives. And Lord, help us to worship you. Help us to open our mouth. Help us to have our tongues sing about your praise and righteousness before all men. Help us to tell others, other transgressors, other sinners like us, help us to teach them about you, that they would be converted to you. Have your own way, Lord, as we pray this in Jesus' name, and amen. Let's all stand as the worship team leads us. You need to come. This altar is open. I'll be glad to pray with you this morning. Whatever that need, if you need to come, Father, we love you. We praise you. God, I know that your word says it will never return void. And Lord, I know that you are speaking to hearts even right now. And God, I pray that the sweet Holy Spirit would not leave each of us alone until we've done business with you. Maybe there's an ought with a brother or sister that we need to deal with. Maybe there is something within our own family we need to, something within our job, something in our life that we just keep pushing aside. God, would you expose it? Would you reveal it so that we can confess and repent of it? That we would be free and have freedom in Christ. We pray this in Jesus' name, and amen. Amen.